We are from ISBR Business School, and we would like to take your interview for our annual magazine, ISBR Voice. Before we embark on the mode of conversation, would like to know your clarion call or message to this young millennial generation towards creating a strong future for the state and the country.
I think the clarion call is very clear. The future is now. The future is now, and I think the kind of socio-economic reforms we are going through, I think this is the best moment for the youngsters and the entrepreneurs of future, the leaders of future, to really take this head on and from here on build their futures and build the future for this country. To my mind, I think the future starts now. Its future is now.
And so, what are your thoughts on harnessing resources for inclusive development of economy and people in both rural and urban areas, and you know, especially people from the lower section of the society?
I think this is a very important question to my mind, and this is one of the biggest challenges we face as a nation. See, if you look at our if you look at the breakdown of our economy, you will see that agriculture accounts for almost 13% or 15% of our economy, and all, but 65% of population is involved in agriculture, which means that very little output for very large number of people, which means that the per capita income of the country is very low, especially of these people who are associated with agriculture. So therefore, it's very, very clear that we have to move towards manufacturing, and services is already doing well. So if you look at the three important elements of economy, one is the agriculture, the other one is industry, this is manufacturing, and third one is services. So in India, we moved from agriculture to services in a much bigger way than the rest of the world. If you look at China went through a huge manufacturing, I would say, revolution. And you look at Korea, you look at Thailand, you look at Japan, you look at Germany. So most of these countries, the manufacturing sector accounts for between 25% to 30% of their, whereas in India it's only 15%, right? So therefore, it's very important for us that we need to move some people from agriculture into manufacturing, and manufacturing will then give you a multiplier effect, okay, which means that it will aid services sector as well, and then it will kickstart a virtuous cycle of growth. So therefore, to my mind, that's very, very important to take to go to the bottom of pyramid to ensure that we grow inclusively, that all sections of society are touched by this growth. Otherwise, growth has no meaning. Correct. If growth is only for a few people or certain sections of society, it will never be sustainable.
Yeah. But sir, do you think that youth would take opportunities from the agriculture and manufacturing sectors? Because there are bigger opportunities in the service industry. So more youth these days they're going to the service industry and the IT industry. Yeah.
Yeah.
So how do you think the youth will move from IT to manufacturing and the agriculture?
No, so what I said was that there are three important pillars of any economy: agriculture, manufacturing and services, right? So manufacturing, all three are important, right? It's not that you can't pay Peter at the cost of Paul. You can't draw Peter and pay Paul. So what we need to do is that all the segments of the economy have to grow. So what we are saying is that manufacturing can anchor our country for the next 20 to 30 years in a much, much better way. It will create more employment and it will get a multiplier effect, because if manufacturing does well, there will be a lot of additional jobs for the services sector. What is services sector? Services sector thrives on manufacturing. If you have high manufacturing, more people will travel, which is services sector. More people will go and use the hotels, which is again services sector. There will be more requirement for software development, which is IT sector, because if manufacturing. So that's very, very important to understand that it's not one at the cost of other. All three have to work in tandem, but manufacturing has to get a lot more focus to become a much bigger player in the global economy, because our foreign trade is, I mean, if you look at our total exports, we are just about 2% compared to 12% of China. Mm-hmm. Our share in the global trade is just 2% versus 12% of China. So there are huge opportunities. So we need to go through the manufacturing path definitely, so that we can grow in a more inclusive way, and we have an all-round growth across the country.
So what are your suggestions to promote collaborative role by public and private partnerships in education and social sectors?
I think this is very important again. I think we are living in a highly disruptive world, a highly volatile world. Innovation is the name of the game. And going forward, you have to bring in innovative solutions for your customers, for various stakeholders, and no one in an entity can do it alone. So therefore, you need partnerships, you need collaborations. So academia can bring in a lot of fundamental and basic research, right? And industry can see how to make it commercially viable, how to use it. So therefore, I think it's very important for industry and academia and government to work better, because government can play the role of a good policy maker to help innovation, to help policies which will encourage entrepreneurship and which will make things ease of doing business a reality. I think those are very, very important. And we in Volvo, we believe in it. That's why we have signed up a very major partnership with Indian Institute of Sciences, IISc in Bangalore. They are our partners for research. We also have preferred partner academic partners across the world and also in India. So we started off with NIT Suratkal some time back. So I think it's very important to my mind that industry and academia work together with the government to create an ecosystem which is very, very, I would say, conducive to innovation, to new ideas, and to incubating the future of this country, to my mind.
Absolutely. That's correct. That was exactly what my next question was. But, okay, something different. What do you think are the three qualities of a leader in prospecting opportunities and challenging the barriers for growth and sustainability in business and society?
So I think there is no single recipe for a great leader. I mean, there is no recipe for saying that, okay, every leader must have these five, six attributes or qualities. But to my mind, there are a couple of things which are very important in being a leader, really a leader. One is that the leader has to be honest. I think the most important quality, he must walk the talk, which means whatever he preaches, he also does it himself. I think that is the second thing. The third is communication. He should be a great communicator. To me, leadership is spelt as communication. Okay? So that is very, very important. So a leader needs to be very... Obviously, he needs to have a vision. Obviously, if you're expecting a leader to lead a company, he must know what he's wanting to do. Whether it's a country, a nation, a school, or an institution, anything, any organization. So I think that's very important. So just to summarize, I think a leader needs to be upfront, candid, honest, should be a good communicator. I think that's very important. And the third thing, another most important thing is he doesn't need to know everything. I mean, a leader is not expected to know everything about everything, right? He must really encourage the right people to take initiatives. He must create an environment where people are free to experiment and make mistakes.
Yeah.
Okay. So I think a leader must encourage people to make mistakes. That's very, very important. And a leader must create more leaders.
Yes, exactly.
And not followers. Yeah. I mean, I don't think a good leader is the one who has 100 followers. I think a good leader is the one who can create 5 more leaders.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
Sir, we would like to know your initiatives as an industry leader in bridging the gap between academia and industry in order to make education relevant to the current needs and also to foster industry collaboration with the educational institution for research and knowledge transfer.
I talked about our partnership with the Indian Institute of Sciences, but I must also share with you that we at Volvo are running an academy called Rasta, R-A-S-T-A, Rasta, which means road, which is affiliated to Visveshwarya Technical University, where we conduct postgraduate program, M.Tech programs on road and highway engineering. Yes, and 50 students at a time are studying there. So every year 25 students graduate. It's a two-year program. So we are ourselves deeply involved in it and trying to bring the best in road and highway engineering affiliated with the local industry have together a very, very important role to play in really figuring out what is the right direction, both the basic research, okay, fundamental research and applied research. And basically, end of the day, solve problems of people. Yeah. Solve problems which have large societal impacts.
So, where did you see yourself while you were pursuing engineering from the IIT?
Yeah, to be honest, I had not scripted a future for myself that I will one day head a company, or I had not imagined that I will follow a particular path. So let me be very honest, it was not that well planned. I think end of the day, what you need is a good attitude. I mean, what I said is that I will give my 100% all the time. I will be willing to learn new things. I will be adaptable. And I will put my best foot forward and walk that extra mile. That's what, if I'm required to do a certain thing, I always would do a little more than what I'm expected to do. I think if we can walk that extra mile, it makes a huge difference. But to be very honest, I didn't have any those grand plans, so to say, that I will at the age of 30, I will be this, at the age of 40, I'll be this, at the age of 50. That's not true at all. It just happened. One is very grateful to God for giving us all these opportunities and to the companies I've worked with.
Okay, so in continuation of a question only, so can you tell us about your journey so far, any specific turning point of your life?
So I started my career with Eicher. I passed out my engineering from IIT in 1981. Then I started my career. I was picked up from the campus by Eicher. I got into tractor industry, which was very well connected with the agricultural economy of the country. So I worked for the first 7-8 years in Eicher. Then I worked for a multinational company in process control instrumentation. Thereafter, I worked for about 8-9 years there as well. Then I went back to tractor industry. Okay. Then I've remained in the automotive industry all through. So I think turning points, I won't say there are any specific turning points. I think there are learning points throughout your journey.
Okay.
I think at every step you learn something new.
Okay.
So I feel that I'm learning something new every day. I have learned things from people who are much lesser educated, much lesser qualified. You've learned from people who were simply very trained and trained mechanics. So I think phenomenal amount of learning. I would say no turning points, lot of learning points. Yeah.
Great. So GST is the most used term in the industry lately. So how do you think GST has impacted the manufacturing industry? Now, what is it, a positive impact or?
Absolutely. I mean, I think in any case, we will come to its impact in a little moment. But I think GST by design is one of the, I would say, far-reaching structural reforms the country will ever see or has seen in the last 70 years. To me, it's much beyond a taxation reform. It's actually a game changer. So GST is actually a game changer, and I think it will it subsumes 15 different taxes into one tax. So it makes it, it can make the ease of doing business a reality. So that's one part. In terms of the implementation, I think these are still early days. It's been just 1 month since GST has been implemented. We will see if there are any major teething issues. Of course, any transformation, anything new which you do, will bring along with it certain challenges. So, but we are happy that the industry is not facing as many challenges as we probably were expecting, that something new of this order could bring in some huge challenges. So far, things have been pretty good. And we believe over the next 6 months, things will completely stabilize. And GST will actually bring lots of advantages to the consumer, to manufacturers, and actually to enlarge the tax base of the country. So every transaction you do under GST regime will leave a trail behind, which means you can be tracked in terms of all transactions. So therefore, you will have a better tax base, which means that over a period of time, the authorities, the government can reduce the tax rates, because once you have a larger base, you can reduce the tax rates, which means you'll have better compliance and you will have the government will have enough to spend on the...
Sir, we are keen to know, how do you spend your typical day?
Quite interesting. So I catch up a lot of stuff while going from point A to point B, which is roughly, I would say, 150 minutes to 200 minutes per day. So I think that's interesting, but I get up early.
As we wind up, sir, we would like to know one word that defines Mr. Kamal Bali.
Walk the extra mile.
Wow. That's